That's good. Bro, I don't have anything.
You have nothing. You have nothing.
He's getting like music in his ear. That's just for you. See the countdown, so.
Well, you just have to go by the time.
I know. What if it's not over? Like, I need to know, like, right when it hits zero.
Why can't we have it on that?
Look at what.
Look at the
people. Yep. People wanted it, man.
Can you see the time?
1:10, okay. Good morning, church family. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome you not only to First Baptist, but to the modern service this morning. So, right? So for those of you who haven't been a part of the church for a while, we used to have a modern service, and then we decided to go into one blended service for a time as we rebuilt the team, we rebuilt the venue, everything for the modern service. And a lot of us have been waiting a very long time for this to happen. And it seems surreal that it's even here right now. I thought I was going to have something like really great to say and really like poignant, but I don't, despite all the time I had. But the one thing that kept coming back to me was the phrase, "You are free." We're free because Christ set us free from our sin, set us free from the grave. And because of that, we're able to freely worship. And if you don't take anything away from today, just remember the fact that you're free. As we go week to week together, hopefully, as we worship together, just remember that you are free and you're free to worship. If you're a first-time visitor with us, we are very excited that you're here. If you will, please fill out a yellow visitor card. We just want to get a little bit of information and give you some information about us so that we can figure out the best ways that we can serve you. And as we begin our worship service, let's go ahead and go into a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day you've given us. We thank you for last week that we celebrated the resurrection. And today we're going to celebrate your resurrection again and again and again. God, we love you. We thank you for your provision, for allowing us to be here to worship you freely. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your Son. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, will you please stand with us as we worship together?
Jesus Christ has won.
tomorrow's in your hands. All I need you will supply, just like you always have.
I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. Don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done.
Your spirit is my hand. He'll fix my eyes on Jesus Christ. I'll say that it is well.
Oh, I know that.
You're doing. Let's raise our voices.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great
to do the offertory, but if you notice, there is a wall right there. So the way we're going to be doing the offering in the service, at least for now, is right back there on the right side of the door, there is a little box. If you would like to put cash or a check in there, just feel free to drop it in that box. Also, when you're on your way out, our church is all about making moments, right? We're trying to get 1 million moments in the next couple of years. We would love to hear your moments. Usually we have a giant moment wall, but there's a reason why it's not out here right now, and it's because it's heavy. But you're still making moments, and we still want to hear those moments. So right outside, there is a box right out there. If you've had a moment, if God has been doing something, maybe God's doing something in your life right now, we would love to hear about that. So at the end of the service, if you wouldn't mind, just write your moment down on the piece of paper and drop it in that box. Now, as we pray, let's prepare our hearts to continue to worship. And if you would like to slip out and drop your offering in that box, you can do that now, or you can wait until the end of the service. You can also give online by scanning the QR code in front of you. So let's pray. Heavenly Father God, you are good, and you are great. How great it is that that you are, Father. God, we thank you so much for this opportunity for us to get to be in here today and worship you, God. We thank you so much for the relaunch of this service, and we thank you for being the God that this is for. This isn't for our glory. This is for yours, Lord. We thank you for that. God, please be with us today as we continue to worship you through our giving and through sharing our moments. Be with us today as we worship you through singing from our hearts, God. And be with us today as we worship you by gleaning the wisdom that Pastor Brian has for us today, this message that he received from you, God. We thank you and we love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
As we continue to worship, will you stand with us, please?
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. The burning sun with golden beam, the silver moon with softer gleam. His hands, his feet, his body bowed and drenched in tears. They laid him down in justice to the entrance sealed by every stone. Messiah stood.
Praise his name.
Led me through the fire. The opportunity to praise you, to worship you, the opportunity that you've given us just to be together as family. We thank you. You are so good. While our songs, our voices, even our thoughts really cannot equal, meet the need to truly praise you for who you are, we try. And we lift our hearts to you today, thanking you in our best efforts to praise you for who you are and what you've done for us. I pray, Lord, as we enter into this time of hearing from your word, that you would open our minds and our hearts to truly hear from you, to be reminded of the importance of what you have done, the weight of what you have done for us. That should compel us. It should inspire us to live our lives as worship for you every day. So be glorified in us, be glorified through us in this time. Lord Jesus, it's in your name we pray it. Amen. Well, I am excited for today to be here. We have planned and prayed and planned for months. In fact, before we even went back to one service, we already had the idea in mind that it would be temporary, that we would come back and have two services, a modern service and a blended service, just as we are celebrating today. So this has been in the works for even before August. And in August, we went back to one service, as you know, and then God has led us to this point to be together in this way. And so I am glad you are here today. I'm glad that you made an effort to be here. I know the times are different. hey, Chris, could you do me a favor? Because this is going to drive me nuts. Will you shut the door to the bride's room? Because I'm sitting here seeing myself in the mirror, and it is not good. Thank you. Yeah, there's always that, you know. Let me just tell you that you are not here by accident. Let me just tell you that all of the effort, all of the prayer, all of the planning, all of the work that's gone into to being back into two services has caught the attention of the enemy. So just know that. And really, that should inspire you. Because if the enemy isn't concerned, we should be worried. And so there's been things going on all morning. We got here early this morning and the air conditioner didn't work. We got ready for the service to start for our blended service and the doors weren't unlocked. It's kind of hard for people to get in when the doors aren't unlocked. All of these things, even at the beginning of the blended service, as I got up to preach, we had a medical emergency in the choir loft. I mean, the enemy is at work. So understand the weight of your presence today. Understand that the enemy is not happy. And that's how Jesus wants it. And so thank you for being here today. Thank you for all of those who had such a part in getting this room ready. That was no small task. Creating and building a worship team for this service. Corey, thank you for your leadership in that. So many things. Mac is just pulling double duty, and Ralph, thank you for all of your work with just making this possible. So enough about that. Let's get to what we're here for, right? Man, I like being on the floor. This is so much better. Probably worse for you, but better for me. And I'm going to pause for just a moment and take a little license. There is a couple in this service today that their presence has still just, every time I look back there and see, I'm blown away. There's a friend of mine, a partner in ministry, that has been a partner since I began ministry. And I didn't know, but she's related to Olivia. And so the Stamies are here today from Fort Worth, and when I saw them walk through the door, I thought, I don't understand. But you chose to be here, Judy, so this is on you. I told her, she said, we were going to go to a different church, but we came here. I said, well, you probably would have heard a better sermon over there, but I'm glad you're here. So let's get to what we're here for. This morning, I want us to think about, last Sunday, we celebrated resurrection. We celebrated an empty tomb, and that tomb is still empty. But the question I have for you is, all of that celebration, all of that excitement about an empty tomb, did you leave it in this building last Sunday? We have a tendency, if we're not careful, to let life happen. And I'm just going to tell you, being very transparent with you, this has been a difficult week. For me, between personal family health issues that Christy and I have been dealing with her parents and my parents, and then in the middle, starting on Monday, having to walk with a family who lost their 15-year-old and doing that memorial service on Thursday. Life happens, and it's been a hard week. And so it's not that difficult for us to let life happen and leave that celebration of resurrection on Easter Sunday. But I want us to think about Easter differently this year. Easter should not be, the resurrection should not be an event that we celebrate one day a year. It ought to be a lifestyle. We are to live resurrected lives. And so over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about what that looks like. Next week, we'll talk about resurrection hope and then resurrection peace. And what it means to live in this life that Jesus created us to live. So I want us to be thinking about Easter differently. It's not just an event. It should be a lifestyle. The resurrection changed everything. I said this last week. I'm going to say it again today, and I'll probably just put you on warning. I'll probably say it next week too. There's no other event in history that redefines human existence as does the resurrection. There's no other event in history that redefines human existence as does the resurrection. It changes everything. It changes everything. It proved for us that God is more powerful than anything we face. He even has the power over natural order. He controls death. He controls life. And if he can raise Jesus from the dead, then I can assure you he can give you the life that you were created to have. And so I want us to be thinking about this differently, that really this resurrection event should change everything about who we are, change us. We were buried with him, Paul says in Romans 6:4. Having been buried with him, we can be raised to walk in a new life. I'll read that passage in just a moment, but think about that for a minute. This new life that he has called us to. If we are truly Jesus' followers, then our lives should look different. New. Resurrected. So over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about that. Today, what I want us to focus on, based on Romans 6:4, is that we are to be buried with him in order to be raised by him so that we can live for him. Let me say that again. We are to be buried with him so that we can be raised by him in order to live for him. Now, I'm going to give you just a little warning. We're going to focus more today on the buried part of that. But there is life. He offers us new life. But the reason I want us to focus on this, if you will let me indulge me for just a moment, this I believe that it is good to talk about life and the life that he's called us to, the life that he's created us for, but we have a tendency not to think about the being buried part. So I want you to bear with me for just a moment as I try to help us understand this key component of our faith. You see, there is no resurrection without a cross. There's no empty tomb without a death. And there's no new life for us without death. I feel that we may have created this problem for ourselves. We may have made it too easy to follow Jesus. In our zeal to win people to Christ, to make disciples, is it possible that we've watered down the fact that we have to die? It cost the first believers everything. Think with me for just a moment. In the first century, when people were hearing about Jesus, hearing his words, following his ministry, and when they made that decision that I'm going to follow him, they knew the cost. It meant changing their religion. When they did that, many of them lost their families. They were excommunicated from their family. That still happens today, by the way, not so much in America, but around the world. Some of them knew that this would cost them their status in the community. Some of them knew that it might even cost them their livelihood, that they may not be able to make money the way that they were making money before. They knew the costs. When they decided to follow and be baptized, they understood the cost. And that's why baptism is such a big issue, especially for the first believers in that first century. They were making it very clear in a very visible way that they had a new life, that they chose a different path. They knew the cost. My question is, do we? Maybe the better question is, does it really cost us anything? In our culture, in our world, does it really cost us anything? Have we made it so culturally normal to be a believer, particularly in America? I mean, I grew up hearing people call America what? A Christian nation. I don't think they people who say that understand the two terms. But have we made it so culturally normal to be a Christian that people don't think about the fact that it costs? Has it become such that it is like joining a health club or the country club? Or, I look around the room, some of this, it'll mean something to you too, AAA. By the way, I've been getting those applications since I was 25 years old. I don't know why. Have we so watered down what it costs us to truly follow Jesus that it's become nothing more than that? A place to be seen. I will not share the city in which I lived, but I have lived in more than one city, pastored in more than one church, where the church was the place that if you worked for a certain company or a certain organization, that you were to be seen. So have we made church a place to be seen? We need to understand this text. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. We were buried with him through baptism into death. We don't focus on that part, do we? We focus on the raised to new life. We don't think about the cost. We don't communicate the costs as we should. I ran across an article this week, just Thursday, and it gave me a lot of concern, and I hope that it concerns you as well. Has anybody in the room ever heard the name Richard Dawkins? A few of you. Richard Dawkins is well known, recognized as one of the most prolific atheists in the world right now. Jim Dennison is his title is theologian in residence. I don't know exactly what that means. But anyway, he is a writer, wonderful theologian, pastor in our state. And he writes this weekly or actually daily blog and devotion. And so I ran across this on Thursday in his devotion. But he says that Dawkins considers himself a cultural Christian. Now listen to what he said. Dawkins said, I do not believe a word of the Christian faith. But then he turned around and identified himself as a cultural Christian. He says, because I would not be happy if we lost all the cathedrals or beautiful parish churches. So listen to what he's saying. I identify as a Christian because look at all the good that Christianity has done. I don't believe a word of it, but look at what it's done. That should give us reason to be alarmed. If that's the view of the world that sees Christianity as just a moral code that may have somewhat lost its importance. In fact, you may have heard the terminology post-Christian culture. That's kind of where we find ourselves now. Post-truth culture, actually, is where we are. But for an atheist to be okay with associating himself as a cultural Christian should be alarming to us. That means that the view of Christianity is not very high. Doesn't seem to be important. And I think part of that is we have made it so easy to follow Jesus or not. To be intentional about being a disciple or not. We need to understand that there is a cost. And I think at the heart of this is maybe a definition that I want you to hear today. The difference between being sorry for something and repenting. Being sorry for something or repenting. Being sorry, even if we mean it, does not necessarily mean that we're going to change our action to prevent that from happening again. It's just that we're remorseful or sorry that we damaged a relationship or that we did this or that and we apologize in hopes of of being forgiven and right relationship being restored. But repentance is different. Repentance is when we apologize and then turn. In fact, the literal word, you've probably seen me do this before, but the literal translation of the word repentance means to turn 180 degrees. If we're walking this way, we turn and go the opposite direction. That's repent. That's what this idea of being buried with him means, that we die to self. At that point that we are walking this way and we make the decision to turn and repent and go a totally different direction, at that moment we are burying ourselves with him. It costs. It means that we're no longer in charge, that we, in a word, surrender. That's what really being buried with him in baptism means. It's surrendering. It's identifying with a new way of living. I believe that's why it's so important that we understand the power of the word immersion. Baptism is really literally the Greek word immerse. It's this idea of not just washing our sins away. I mean, we kind of have that idea, but it's also coming out as a different person, a new creation. And so we need to understand that there is a death. There is a surrender to giving up control. Aren't you glad you came today? We don't like being told we can't be in charge, right? We don't like somebody else telling us what to do. That's natural. In fact, if you go back to the very first of creation, I may have said this last week, I don't remember. That's fun. It's a funny thing about being a pastor. You say things and you don't remember what you say. In Genesis, we find that God put Adam and Eve in the garden, right? And he said, you can eat from anything you want, but don't eat from this one tree. And that has baffled theologians and philosophers for years since then. Why would God do that? He did that to give us a choice. We have a choice. We have a choice. And because sin is in our lives, we need to understand that we need to die to that way in order to live for him. And that same understanding, God created all of this for good. After I said, I do remember saying this last week. After each one of the creations, each days of creation, what did he say? It is good. He didn't go, meh. He said, it is good. But then sin entered the world, and it distorted and twisted everything that God created for good. And that's your story, and that's my story. God created us for a life. And I talked about this life last week, and I'll talk about it in the next 2 weeks. He created us for a life. The problem is sin distorts that and twists that and changes that. And Jesus came to make a way for that to be right. And so we need to understand this idea that we must surrender. We must be buried with him. We lay down our old ways. We give up control. That's that whole issue with the tree. When the tempter came, when Satan came and he said, why don't you eat from that tree? Eve said, well, God said we can't eat from that tree or we'll die. And what does he say? You won't die. You'll become like God. That's the heart of sin. Wanting to be in control. It's natural. So we need to realize we must surrender. Come to the end of ourselves. We realize that we can't do this on our own, and we give in to him, and we are buried with him. Jesus' body was laid in that tomb, illustrating his death. His love for us cost him everything. So we are to join him in this act by laying down our life, sacrificing ourselves, surrendering ourselves to him. When we do this, then he can raise us to a new life, the life that we were created to have. When you surrender to him, your old ways are buried with him, and you are raised I believe the resurrection, as I said a moment ago, that changes everything. Resurrection is the key to our living. It shows that death is not the end, but rather the beginning. Resurrection shows us that death isn't the end, it's the beginning. His resurrection not only brought life back to him, it offers us life as well. Yes, we must die to ourselves, but we do so with the very promise of a better life, the life he created us to have. Life beyond this existence, but life here and now as well. Life here and now, free of fear. Free of the fear of death. Hebrews chapter 2, 14 and 15. It talks about the fact that Jesus had to come to suffer and die and be raised so that he could defeat death and free us, it says in Hebrews 2, 15. Free us from a life of fear of death. A life lived in fear of death. He frees us from that so that we don't have to worry every morning when we get up. We don't have to worry. There's nothing to fear. Paul says, in fact, he says, to live is Christ and to die is what? Gain. To live is Christ. To live, that's beautiful. To be with him, to interact with him, have a relationship with him. To live is Christ. But to die, even better. Now, we don't like to hear that, I understand, but that's the reality. And so we don't have to worry. So that allows us to live in freedom, to live this life that he created us to have, that sin distorted. Resurrection is a symbol of a new creation, the first day of something new, redemption. Jesus came to redeem us. Alistair McGrath is an Irish theologian, Anglican priest. He says, the resurrection of Jesus is a sign of God's purpose and power to restore his creation to its full stature and integrity. Just as death could be seen as the culmination of all that is wrong with the world, so the resurrection can be seen as a pledge of God's ultimate victory over the disorder which plagues his creation on account of the fall. In other words, Jesus came. He died and he rose again to redeem what sin has damaged beyond repair. We are raised by him. We are buried with him so that he can raise us himself, so we can be raised by him. And your baptism is a symbol of being raised up by him to a new life. Your baptism is a symbol of being raised up by him to a new life. And I said earlier, we'll talk more about this new life next week, but the thing I want to leave us with today is this life is a life that's supposed to be lived for him. He didn't go through all of that. He didn't come to earth and die for us and rise again so that we could just enjoy going to a Hooks game or going to the beach. Did that so that we would live for him. I ran across a verse this week from 2 Corinthians, and it really gave me pause, and I feel like it fits what we're talking about today. 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 15 say, Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. What caused me pause was in the first phrase, Christ's love compels us. I had to ask my question, am I compelled? Does his love compel me to truly live for him? Am I convinced? He says the second phrase there, because we are convinced that one died for all. Am I convinced? Does my life, because I follow Jesus, look any different than someone's life who doesn't? That's the question we've got to ask each other and ourselves, mostly ourselves. In fact, don't look around right now and point fingers. The question is somebody outside of the church, do they look at you and see any difference? Or is this just another social gathering that you belong to, just like you might some other social gathering in town? Our lives should look different because he raises us to walk in a new life, a new creation, a new way. In fact, Isaiah 43, I kind of blew right past this, but God reminds the Israelites. He says, don't look at the past and all the things I've done. Look today. Can't you see? I'm doing a new thing. I really felt that this idea of something new fit really well with what we're doing today, because everything about this morning has been new. People trying to find where to go, people trying to find where to sit, what time are we supposed to be here, where am I, you know, all of those kind of questions. God is doing something new, and he has raised us in order to live that new life, the life he created us to have. So how compelled are we to do that? How different are we? Our lives should look different in many different ways, like the way we think, the way we act, the way we treat one another, the way that we love. Our lives should reflect a difference. Learning to follow Jesus, I believe, is a lifelong endeavor. I don't think we're going to make a decision to follow Jesus and then tomorrow be perfect at it. In fact, you've heard me say this before, but following Jesus is a one-time lifelong commitment, but it is a daily decision. It's a daily decision. We have to choose every day, are we going to follow him? Are we going to live for him? And so I believe we learn more and more. That's what being a disciple is growing in our faith, understanding more. So I'm not going to tell you that we all are going to have this figured out by Tuesday. But we are to strive to live this new life, deciding every day to live for him. There's a lot to learn, and I say this often too. I hope I know more about following Jesus today than I did 10 years ago. And I pray that I will know more in 10 years than I do today. But today, we need to follow him. We need to live our lives to serve him. And so I'm going to give you a place to start. Love God with all you have. And love your neighbor as yourself. Now, there's a lot more to learn, but that's a great place to start. Your new life is to be lived as worship to him. We are buried with him to be raised by him in order to live for him. That's the Christian walk. There's a cost involved, and we need to be fully aware. But let me just tell you from personal experience, the benefits far outweigh the cost. My challenge for us as we close is the power of the resurrection is that it creates something new. So live into your new life each day. That's what he has for us. That's what he wants from us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. I thank you, more importantly, for what you've done. The fact that you have come in order to die on a cross for us so that you could be raised, defeating sin, defeating death. You have come so that we can be buried with you in order to be raised by you so that we can live for you. So help us remember that today, that it starts with surrender. It starts with us giving ourselves fully to you, knowing that you have a life planned for us that we could never imagine, better than anything we could ever dream. Lord, I pray today, if there's anyone in this room that's never done that, never surrendered their life to you, I pray this day would be the day. I can't think of a better day to change a life than today. And Lord, for those of us in this room who have made this decision days, years before, help us remember that our lives are to be lived to glorify you, to serve you, lived as worship of you. So may we be compelled to do that starting today. Lord Jesus, it's in your name we pray it. Amen. Just a moment, I'll have you stand for a time of response. I don't know how God's working in your heart, in your life, but as I just prayed, if there's anyone in this room that's never surrendered your life to him, to truly buried yourself and your old way of life so that you can live a new life, if you haven't done that, I'd love to talk to you about that. John will be here, Mike will be here, I'll be here. If you'd like prayer, we'll be here. Any decision you'd like to make, we're here. But take this time, as we sing together in just a moment, take this time to truly reflect on the fact that there is a cost to following Jesus, but the benefit far outweighs that cost. And the result is that we are to live for him each and every day. So reflect on those things as we stand and sing together.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power.
Just a few announcements for everyone before we go. Excuse me. The first one is going to be the Senior Adult Luncheon. That is going to be on Sunday, May 5th in Elmore at 11:30. Tickets are going to be $10. Tickets are $10, and I think we're going to start selling those this week, the week after next. So make sure you get a ticket for that if you want to attend the Senior Adult Luncheon. Senior Adult Luncheon, okay? So not just because you're a senior in high school, like senior adults, okay? After that is the Ladies Spring Tea. This is the Ladies Spring Tea, ladies only. So this is Saturday, April 27th, 10:30 to 12:30. It's going to be at Elmore Hall. We already have booths and tables that are being taken for that. So if you want to go, we have a table set up, I believe, right outside, and you can get a ticket for that. We have, as the church, a season membership to the Corpus Christi Hooks. So if you would like to go to a Hooks game, please get in contact with Chris or Diane at the Rec Center, and we can get you up to 4 tickets and a parking pass for a Hooks game. And after that is going to be the youth fundraiser. That is one of my favorite Sundays, where our youth will do everything for us. They'll lead us in worship. They'll lead children's time for us. So make sure you're here for that. It will be in both services on the 28th. At the end of the month, it'll be our youth-led service and fundraiser with a lunch afterwards for the youth. Pastor B, close us out.
That'll be a good time. Always is. Always is. Are you glad you came today? That wasn't super overwhelming, but I'm gonna trust that you're glad that you're here. I'm pumped that we're here. I'm pumped that this day has finally come, and I'm glad that you made it a priority to be here today as well. As we are dismissed today, may the God who created us out of love, who came and died for us and rose again out of love, remind us that we are to be buried with Him, in order to be raised by Him so that we can live for Him. May we be about that starting now. Amen. We're dismissed. Amen.